presents this unabridged recording of Great Australian Scams, Cons and Rorts, written and read by Jim Haynes. This book is for my niece, Alison Dellett, and all her colleagues at the National Library of Australia, who, by their persistent commitment to Trove, make books like this one possible. Introduction. Australian history is almost always picturesque. Indeed, it is so curious and strange that it is itself the chiefest novelty the country has to offer, and so it pushes the other novelties into second and third place. It does not read like history, but like the most beautiful lies. And all of a fresh new sort, no mouldy old stale ones. It is full of surprises and adventures and incongruities and contradictions and incredibilities, but they're all true. They all happened. Mark Twain, Following the Equator. Whenever I told anyone I was writing about Australian scams, cons and rorts during the time that I was researching and writing this collection, the most common comment was something along the lines of, "Well, there's no shortage of material there," or, "You'll have plenty to choose from." It seems that many Australians are of the opinion that our nation has a particularly rich history of deceitful behaviour, cunning plans to relieve the gullible of their hard-earned cash, and imaginative and risky schemes designed and carried out with a certain particularly Australian panache and daring. Perhaps it is so. Although I'm quite sure every nation has its fair share of risk-taking, daring and imaginative scammers and conmen. When our national character is discussed, much is often made of our convict beginnings. And it is true that European settlement in Australia began with Sydney Cove being used as a dumping ground for the unwanted criminal elements of British society. This undeniable historic fact has been used to explain many elements of our national character, including our tolerance of alcohol, a tendency to bend the rules here and there, and the belief that everyone deserves a fair go. Whether these traits are part of any real national character or not is a very moot point. Perhaps this mythical Australian character is something we'd like to believe. Perhaps it is merely part of the romance of the past. Still, it is fascinating to read Mark Twain's assessment of Australia at the end of the 19th century, and I suspect he was onto something. When Twain visited and made his observations, the European history of Australia was just a century old. The unmistakable influence of transportation, exploration, and the discovery of gold were still very much a part of the society he experienced, analysed, and enjoyed. There are themes that run through the stories in this collection, yet I didn't set out to collect and relate the stories with any particular themes or subjects in mind. I simply look for entertaining examples of clever and deceitful behaviour. One odd thing I noticed about the con men I chose to write about is that so many were really big men. Lawrence Hargraves, George Cochrane and Harry Redford all stood over 6'2", 190 centimetres, and the Tichborne claimant weighed almost 26 stone, 170 kilograms. On the other hand, Peter St. Albans weighed about 32 kilograms and Jack De Garis was 4'11" tall, 149 centimetres. They were all, however, larger than life in some way or another. On a more serious note, I found that certain subjects, social issues and personality traits turned up again and again, especially events to do with gold, art, forgery and horses, as well as themes of opportunity, rebellious spirit and class struggle. I'm sure that these things are not specifically unique to our national spirit and history, but I suspect that the combination of these elements is often especially Australian. I'll leave you to decide. The Mongrel. This is the best piece of bush verse about a spontaneous con job ever. My old mate Graham Watt is one of those bush poets who always gets it right when he writes about small town characters. Graham has a knack of capturing in verse the dry Aussie sense of humour and that laconic, deceitful manner of spinning a yarn that seems to come so easily to many bushmen. The Mongrel, Graham Watt. Who owns the mung in the corner? The bloke at the bar loudly said. He's breathing his last breath, I reckon. That poor blessed dog looks near dead. And dogs aren't allowed, where I come from, to frequent hotels in the town. Who owns this excuse for a canine? He'd be much better off if put down. A silence hung there for a minute. Then a whiskery old drover spoke up. That's my dog. Young fella, he's my dog. And I've had him since he was a pup. You're right, he's old and decrepit. Like me, here's not long to go. But that mung, as you call him,'s my best friend. No better mate could you know. For me and that dog have enjoyed life. We both talked a language the same. We shared the hot days and the water bag thirst as we worked in the mustering game. And that dog saved my life in the outback when thrown from me horse far away. That dog ran for help and led the men back. Oh, I owe him my life, you could say. I reared him on scraps from me feed bag and I taught him to fetch and to heel. Oh, I'd say you're a stranger to these parts or you'd know just the way that I feel. Yes, he's old and it's cruel now to see him. No dog should have earned such a fate. Last Friday I picked up me rifle, but how could I shoot me best mate? I even asked that young vet bloke, how much to give my dog rest? $50, he said, is the fee for the job, but with money I've never been blessed. The stranger grew quiet at the story. He glanced at the bar drinking crew. He said, oh, sorry, old timer, I spoke out of turn. I can see what that dog means to you. Here's $50 to have him put down, and you'll have to excuse me, I fear. I know it's hard to lose a good friend, one so close and so near. The stranger shook hands with the drover and quickly departed the room. A silence hung over the drinkers, a sort of a sadness and gloom. But then the old drover said, spark up. Things aren't that bad, for you see, that city bloke left $50, so now all the drinks are on me. Drink up, you blokes, name your poison, and drink to that mung, he's a swell. If his owner was here, well, I'd kiss him and shout him a few drinks as well. Section 1. Disappearances and reappearances. The case of the disappearing picture. The truth cannot be woven out of a string of lies. Fred Munoz. The backstory. This is the complicated story of the disappearance of a work of art that was an image of Sydney as it was in 1800, drawn by a famous British artist named Edward Days. Now, you may be wondering how Edward Days came to draw a picture of the colony of New South Wales, given the fact that he certainly never went there. To answer this properly, we need to attempt to understand how the British public were made aware of and accurately informed about what was going on in the far-flung dominions of the British Empire and what life was like in those strange and exotic lands in distant parts of the globe. During the 18th century and the early years of the 19th century, there was a fascination in Europe for anything to do with the exotic and newly settled lands of the Pacific. Books purporting to tell the deeds of explorers and navigators or to describe the strange and wonderful flora and fauna of those distant lands very quickly sold out. It was not just the scientific and academic community that was prone to this fascination. The popular press of the day soon discovered that accounts and depictions, both true and false, of life at Botany Bay, as the colony was mostly known in Britain at the time, were eagerly purchased and read, and indeed believed, by a curious and often gullible public. While some of these publications were accurate accounts, such as the journals of Captain Cook and the diaries of First Fleet officials, Judge Advocate Collins, Surgeon John White, and Soldier Watkin Tench, others were fake accounts, cobbled together by opportunistic journalists from scraps of information gleaned from the genuine accounts. Books in this latter category often contained false information added to give colour, and drawings that were simply copied from any depiction of New South Wales, good or bad, real or imagined, that the unscrupulous creators of such books could lay their hands on. There are no better examples of this than the three books and handful of drawings attributed to the famous jewel thief George Barrington. George Barrington was the most famous criminal ever sent to Botany Bay. He was, according to the newspapers of the day, something akin to the Scarlet Pimpernel, Robin Hood and Beau Brummel all rolled into one. He mixed freely in the best of social circles and picked pockets at the royal court during the Queen's birthday celebrations in 1775. He was also a master of disguise and often dressed as a minister of religion and picked pockets and stole jewellery from wealthy women while they were actually wearing it. London society was all agog at the exploits of this famous thief and expert pickpocket, and his exploits were the subject of millions of words in newspapers and broadsheets of the time. He was so well liked that although he was arrested more than a dozen times and convicted at least 8 times, he was actually pardoned on more than one occasion and let off lightly by judges on quite a few others. Often he was able to talk his way out of being convicted at all. His silver tongue, eloquent speeches, fashionable dress and genteel manners often convinced a jury that it was all a terrible mistake or a misunderstanding, or even that he had merely found misplaced items and was returning them. Barrington was finally convicted once too often and sent to New South Wales on the Third Fleet in 1791. He turned out to be a model prisoner and was pardoned and made a constable by Governor Phillip. He died in 1804, but his fame lasted long after his death. He is credited with so many adventures and crimes and daring deeds that he would have needed to live 3 lifetimes to have done them all. Fake news is not a recent innovation. For example, while on the voyage out to Sydney, Barrington was credited by the press as having prevented a mutiny, and a long, sentimental letter to his long-suffering wife begging forgiveness and swearing repentance appeared in the London newspapers, although he certainly never wrote it. Although absent from England, his notoriety continued. In a popular broadside ballad, The Jolly Lad's Trip to Botany Bay, a group of convicts laugh about being transported and swear that the first thing they will do in New South Wales is take over the colony and appoint a king. For who knows but it may be the noted Barrington. He was credited with many publications, letters, journals and theatre pieces, but he certainly never wrote the books that appeared in his name. 2 books called A Voyage to New South Wales and A History of New South Wales were selling in London shops in the last years of his life, and another entitled A History of New Holland was published 4 years after his death. These all sold very well, and no one to this day knows who wrote any of them, though one seems to have been based on the published journals of Judge Advocate David Collins. Barrington wrote none of them, and was also certainly not the author of the much-quoted speech supposedly given by him as a prologue at the opening of the first Australian theatre in 1796. In the same way that some written accounts were true and accurate while others were false and wildly imaginative, so too visual representations of the colony fell into 2 categories. Some were crudely drawn, inaccurately copied and quickly engraved and published to take advantage of the British public's fascination with Botany Bay. Indeed, some were simply made up. George Barrington almost certainly didn't draw the original pictures engraved and published in his name in London in 1802, although they are so naively composed that it could just be possible. Some depictions of the colony of New South Wales were, however, accurate representations drawn by reasonably talented amateur artists, officials, soldiers, and convicts. Some of these were then accurately redrawn by professional artists and skillfully engraved in London by the best and most respected engravers of the day. View of Sydney Cove, New South Wales, from an original picture in the possession of Isaac Clemenson Esquire, 1802, drawn by E. Days from a picture painted at the colony, engraved by F. Jukes, is probably the most important of these works. Good examples of the rare engraving have fetched almost $20,000 at auction. Possibly the original painting was by the acclaimed convict artist John Eyre. Somehow the original painting made its way to the home of Mr. Clemenson in Britain, where it was carefully and artistically copied by the skilled hand of Edward Days before being engraved and printed by the famous London engraver Francis Jukes, whose works are also greatly valued and highly collectible. So you can see why someone thought it was worth the risk to make it disappear, i.e. steal it. It wasn't, however, its disappearance that led its owner, Mr. John Pickles, to visit the Rose Bay police station. It was its reappearance. The story.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.